Hey everyone, this is Dan Duran from Red, and today we'll be going over Adobe Premiere Pro's workflow with a REDCODE RAW R3 footage, as well as in-camera generated ProRes clips. So let's go ahead and dive in. Before you start a project, make sure you're on the latest version of Premiere Pro. This puts you in a great starting position and usually helps troubleshoot most workflow issues I see. Today I'll be running Adobe Premiere 15.1, however I'm sure there'll be a newer release version by the time you're watching this. The great thing about Adobe is that they've always been able to read REDCODE RAW footage natively, so you don't need to install any plugins that work with REDCODE RAW footage. However, we will be using our IPP2 output transform LUTs, which you can download from red.com. Just go to the support tab on the website and select downloads, scroll down to the bottom and download the IPP2 output presets. Also, if you want to create a custom IPP2 LUT, you can do that in REDCine-X, which I'll be going over later on in the video. For this tutorial, we'll be using the LUT package a little bit later on, but now let's jump into Adobe Premiere Pro. Like all workflow videos, the first thing that we have to do is ingest the footage. This should always be done with the Media Browser tool, because REDCODE RAW footage is captured as segmented R3D files, and the Media Browser tool will read them as one single clip. The reason REDCODE RAW clips are segmented is for safety reasons while recording, as well as compatibility with all hard drive formats. If you were to use File Import to bring in your footage, it would actually bring in each segmented R3D as its own clip, and that's something you do not want. In the Media Browser window, you can hit the tilde key, which will make your current window full screen. From here, you'll see that these are all raw clips because they have the .r3d in the file name. You can even preview the raw clips by moving your mouse over them. Now let's select the clips we want to ingest. Right click and hit import. From here, let's go to the project window and you can see all the clips we just selected have been imported into the project. Let's go ahead and bring a few of these clips over to the timeline. I'll verify that our sequence settings are set to my deliverable at this point. For instance, I know this project was for a UHD 4K finish, so I'll double check that resolution is set to 3840 by 2160. You're going to notice that the current clips look cropped now. That's because some were shot in 8K and 6K. Now to get the proper frame size, you can right click on them all and select set to frame size. However, a little tip I usually do to save some time is to set my Premiere preferences to automatically apply this when I bring clips into the timeline. This can be done by going to the preferences, media, then changing the default media scaling to set to frame size. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the footage. The biggest change you're going to see in Premiere 15 is that red footage defaults into a log looking image now, which is fantastic. The previous way clips came into Premiere locked users into a Rec 709 BTN 1886 working space from the start. Now Red RAW footage will always come in as Log 3G10 and Red Y Gamut RGB, which means you're going to be starting out with the full flexibility of working with all the image data and dynamic range that the camera has to offer in your workflow. We also made these changes to be the default behavior of R3Ds in all third-party applications to unify the results and deliver consistent and predictable workflow no matter what software you are working in. So now, how do we easily take our Log 3G10 image and bring it into a common display space like Rec 709? This is where we can use one of the IPP2 output preset LUTs that we downloaded at the start, which gives you several pre-made LUT options. However, there is going to be a time or place where you might need to generate a custom IPP2 LUT, which can be done directly in REDCine-X. To do this, let's open up REDCine-X and go to File, IPP2 LUT Creator. From here, you're going to be able to select the destination color space, which I'll use Rec 709 because it's still one of the most commonly viewed color spaces. And for gamma curve, I'm going to select 2.4 gamma, which is our BTN 1886. For output tone map, I'm going to select medium contrast, and for highlight roll off, I'm going to select soft. For cube size, I'm going to keep it on our default of 33, and then I'm going to save the LUT to my documents folder. Now let's jump back into Premiere Pro and apply the custom IPP2 LUT we just made at REDCine-X, or you can even use one of the ones we downloaded at the start. I'm now going to make this a little easier by clicking on the color workspace on the top of Premiere Pro to give me the cleanest workspace to apply my LUTs with the Lumetri color panel. On the right hand of Premiere Pro, you'll see that the Lumetri panel is now pinned to the side, and I'm going to open the Creative tab LUT location. It might be a little counterintuitive, but that creative look LUT location is actually going to be putting the LUT on the end of the image chain, which is where we want our IPP2 LUTs to be. So let's select and browse for the custom Rec 709 IPP2 LUT we created in REDCine-X and hit apply. Now that we have applied the LUT, you can see that the image is no longer that flat red wide gamut log 3G10, but is now in our Rec 709 BT1886 your 2.4 gamma. What's great is now we can create a lumetri preset of this by going to the three lines by lumetri color and selecting save preset. Let's name it IPP2 Rec 709 medium contrast soft highlights so we can keep everything easily organized. Now the cool part about this is that I can apply this preset to all my REDCODE RAW footage. The preset will be saved in your effects window under presets, and as you can see, the one we just made is here. Also, you can right click and select export preset if you ever need to send this to anyone else in editorial. Now let's go ahead and apply the preset we just made. So there are multiple ways of doing this. The most popular way is applying the preset to the clips in your timeline directly because it will streamline any of your other lumetri adjustments directly during the editing process. Another option is applying the preset to the R3D clips in your bin, or even creating a smart search bin where you can look directly for all your raw R3D clips. Lastly, the preset can be dropped into a top level adjustment layer, which can even run the length of your entire timeline and will automatically be applying to any image beneath it in the timeline. Last thing I wanted to go over is how to access the R3D RAW parameters in Premiere. In most cases, you're going to leave them as is, which defaults to what was set in camera, but it's good to know where they are if you ever need to make any specific adjustments. To get there, select an R3D clip, go to Effects Controls, and select Source. Here is where you'll have access to all the RED RAW metadata parameters. We have As Shot, if you need to reset the image to what was set in camera, Default, which will set the clip to the factory default metadata settings, Reload from RMD if you made any adjustments in REDCine-X, and Save to RMD, which will save any adjustments made to the RAW settings into a sidecar file for other software tools to read and when the R3 file is opened in them. If you have a RedRocket card, this is where you can select to use it. Next is Image Pipeline, which I always recommend having in IPP2 to take advantage of our latest color pipeline. For Demosaic Denoise, you can leave it at the default 0 because it's not being used with IPP2. DEB is using our latest chroma noise reduction in IPP2, and I highly recommend having it checked on. This should automatically be on when bringing in some of our newer Komodo footage into Premiere. For decoding, using camera orientation should always be checked off. In my opinion, if you need to change orientation of the image, it's easier to do it within the motion settings of Premiere itself. If you have an HDR clip, you can select the track and blend the options here. For debayer detail, I always recommend keeping it on high, which it defaults automatically to. In primary, you'll see the color space is set to red, white, gamut, RGB, and gamma curve as log 3G10. These cannot be changed because it's the foundation of IPP2, and it's just letting you know what the space the raw files are in. Next is ISO, which will default to whatever was shot in camera, but can be adjusted here if needed. There's also exposure if you ever need more precise adjustments. Next section is your color temperature adjustments. Premiere has the ability to auto white balance using the eyedropper if needed. Then you have your Kelvin and tint raw adjustments as well. They will also both default to what was set in camera. You'll notice we also have a creative 3D LUT option here. This will populate with the LUT if one was used in camera. If that is the case, you might not need to apply one of the IPP2 output transform LUTs. Usually this will be easy to tell because your image will most likely not be coming in as log. However, it is important to know that this LUT is being applied very early in the image pipeline. So if this LUT, say, brings everything up 2 stops and ends up clipping your highlights, you won't be able to retrieve those highlights using the lumetri color panel. Next is your color decision list metadata parameters. This will populate with any adjustments if CDLs were used in camera. You can also disable them if needed with the checkbox. Finally, you'll notice that Premiere also has the ability to adjust the output transform settings through the RAW controls. These settings are here because Premiere used to decode images directly into Rec 709 BT8086. You still have the ability to control the gamma curve, color space, tone map, and highlight roll off here, but I really wouldn't recommend it. Because if you do, any adjustments made through lumetri would happen on top of the image, severely restricting your latitude in post. One other useful feature to know is that you can save R3D source settings as a preset as well. However, the one thing to keep in mind is it saves every single metadata parameter to the preset. So if you mass apply this preset, it will also change ISO, color temp, and everything else on the image. Well, that does it for our Premiere Pro workflow tutorial. Thanks for watching, and feel free to like and subscribe so you can keep up to date on the next RedTech.